So as usual, we're going to start just reviewing a bit what we saw last time. I wrote most of the stuff on the board because I would like to tell you a bit about the new material we want to cover today. And more or less last time, we had a long review because I have the impression that for some reason it didn't sink in of logistic regression and SVM, just from a somewhat different perspective, just using essentially gradient descent and subgradient techniques, both to solve the problem and to characterize the solution. If you want, the highlight of the last class was this idea that you can recover the super vector's definition just by a straightforward computation of left and right derivatives of the loss function without having to go to a duality argument, okay? Which greatly simplifies the story. Just a small recap of what we did next, which was looking at least squares, okay? So we stick to Tikhonov-like functions, so penalized empirical risks, but in particular we focus on the square loss, okay? We first looked at the case where the kernel is chosen to be the linear kernel, okay? Just the inner product. In this case, the functions are just linear functions, and we can reparameterize everything in terms of W. And we know that the one W that solves this problem is just given by the solution of this linear system. Okay? Just quickly, can you remind me what is the complexity of solving this linear system? Let's say that the matrix X, which is the data matrix, has n rows and d columns. So n points, each with d features. What's the complexity of solving this? It's n d square. Let's just drop the rest because it's negligible in this case. So we're, let's say, or if you want, let's put both, but it won't matter too much. And then what's the space requirement for solving this problem? It's basically nd. Okay? So this is space, and this is time. And then we moved on and showed that if you actually consider nonlinear kernel, generic nonlinear kernels K, where you might or might not have a feature representation of this kind, and so you want to mostly stick to the something that depends only on having the possibility to compute in the kernel function. In this case, for a generic positive definite kernel, we know that the solution to this problem, where here now this one is the reproducing kernel Hilbert space associated to the kernel, is just given by this linear combination. The representative theorem, combination of kernel functions at the training set points, with coefficients, there are now n coefficients, whereas here notice that we had d coefficients, that are given by the solution of this linear system, okay? Where k hat is just the kernel matrix. So the matrix whose entries are the comparison on any two pairs of points in the training set via the kernel function, okay? So far so good? There are a couple of ways to derive this. It's in both cases, it's just pretty much computing a derivative of a squared loss function and set it equal to zero. What is the complexity of this guy? It's basically n cube. Okay? There is also, where was this coming from? In the linear case? The multiplication. Where has this gone here? Evaluation of the kernel matrix, which is going to be what? Well, I have to compare endpoints against endpoints, and then you have to tell me how much is the cost of the comparison. Okay? Let me just call it Q. Q is the cost of computing the kernel function. And in this reasoning, I'm going to consider it to be a constant, but truly it will depend on the dimension of the data. For example, if you have the Gaussian kernel, this is Q is actually going to be D. Okay? But here we're thinking of a scenario where N is larger than this d, the dimension of the data, and yet much smaller than the dimension of the space, which is in this case infinite. Okay? So, in some sense, this one and this one are the leading complexity in these two computations. What is the memory requirement in this case? what is the biggest thing you have to store? This one here, it's just going to be n squared. Okay? Okay, so there are many, many ways of solving problems like this. The matrices are nice, they are symmetric positive definite, so Cholesky decomposition is probably like the method of choice in this situation, but there are many, many other ways of solving these kind of problems. The typical idea is that you don't want to invert the matrix. You want to go straight to the solution of the problem. You don't want to first invert the matrix and then apply it. You want to find try to find approaches that try to give you a solution, try to solve the linear system directly. Okay? Typically, this means that instead of using the in, for example, in MATLAB, is rather than using first the in function and then apply the matrix, you want to do something like the backslash, which is exactly exploiting the fact that you have a linear system to solve rather than just a matrix inversion. Now, the last thing we said last time, and this is the only one I would like to review a little bit, is that the problem of this technique, for a couple of observations. The first one is, this is the complexity for a generic kernel. Suppose for a minute that you have a kernel that admits an explicit feature representation that you know, okay, you have the feature, and the features are finite dimensional. Okay, so it's basically what I wrote here. Suppose that the specific kernels you're considering is not a generic kernel. It's a kernel for which you have an explicit expression given by a feature map, which is finite dimensional, so you can handle it. Okay? In this case, what I'm claiming is that you're basically back to the linear case, where you can just write the function this way. You can always do it, but usually this is a this feature map is infinite dimensional, so this makes your life harder. But in this case, you can do it because this guy is finite dimensional. It's just Rm. Okay? So suppose that I give you a kernel that admits, for which I give you a kernel and a finite dimensional feature map, such that the kernel is simply defined this way. Okay? Or if you want the other way around, I give you the finite dimensional feature map, and I just tell you, okay, define a kernel just this way. Of course, now you can use this. Okay? But is this always the best idea? You see the question? I give you the feature map, which is m-dimensional, and then you define the kernel just through this equation. Then at this point, you can just use it this way. Is this a good idea in general? From a computational point of view. Yes or no?
Depends on the ratio divided by m.
Depends on what?
The relation between m.
It depends on the relation between m and n. Okay? How? Suppose, for example, that m is much, much larger than n. Then what would you do? If m, say, is 10 times larger than n, the number of points, then what would you do? Which algorithm would you run? Which one? This one or this one? This one or this one? Who says this one? Who says this one? What about everybody else? So you want to use this one, right? Because M is much, much larger than n. So you want the complexity to be led by n, okay, which is the smallest quantity you have. But suppose the other way around. N is huge, okay, but m is much smaller. At this point, what you can notice is that there is really no difference between this case and the linear case. It's just that instead of x, now you have a new vector that you call phi tilde x. You can call it x tilde if you want. It's just another vector. So clearly, you can also use this. What's going to be the difference? Well, y remains unchanged. X is not really the data matrix anymore. You first have to map each point into this new vector and then build the new data matrix, correct? And the rest is the same. The algorithm doesn't change. You only have to change the definition of this. Is this clear? You want me to write down the matrix explicitly? instead of x hat, you would need a matrix, say, x tilde, where the first row is phi tilde x1, and the last row is phi tilde xn. So this matrix is n by d. How big is this? It's n by m. The rest is the same, OK? What's the complexity of this method now? Suppose the case where m is much smaller than n. What is the complexity of that? Well, we want to use this, not with the original matrix, but with this new matrix. So all we have to do is to read this one line. And whenever we say d, we should say thank you, guys. OK? So this is the case where you know that the kernel you're using is exactly given by a finite dimensional feature map. This same idea, the idea of exploiting this, exactly this fact, is one of the tricks you use when you have a generic kernel, but you have too many points to fit this in memory. What you do is that you first basically replace this equality. You try to find some phi tilde that for a given kernel are going to give you not inequality, but inequality. OK, so instead of an equality, now you put an inequality. So this is not anymore an exact solution. It's an approximate solution, where you replace the true kernel with a finite dimensional approximation so that you can go from this complexity to this complexity. OK, it's a trick to go from this complexity to this complexity. The idea here is that the bigger is m, the more accurate should be this approximation. OK? So last time I announced a couple of methods, OK? And here really, I mean, I'm emphasizing a bit this step here. There is really not much going on, OK? But because this is really the main idea. The main idea is to go from this complexity to this one just by using this finite dimensional feature map. The rest is to invent this feature map. And there are many, many possible choices. And then I'm going to give you a couple, OK? The first one is basically the one that says, look, I want to use all the data in my empirical error. But here, in this expansion, rather than n points, I want to use m, chosen in some way, perhaps at random, from the training set points. So this is the first case. And it is easy to convince yourself. This is exactly equal to phi tilde x beta in Rm, where phi tilde is defined how? What is the phi tilde for which this equality holds? Come on. Do it a bit quicker than this. It's a very tricky inner product in Rm of two vectors. One is called beta. The other one I have to tell you how to define it. And it's just simply this guy, right? K x, x1, k x, x m, right? Fair enough. This is the first method. The second method is a bit more exotic. It looks like this. This one we already said. This is I'm going to be quickly here because there is not much, OK? So you choose uniformly at random the point, m point, from your training set. You don't optimize it. You just choose uniformly at random. And then you define this. And then you just have to go in this one line. And there's nothing else. So you're basically in the linear case. The second one looks a bit more exotic. So let me just write it like this. Let me just write here to make it clear that this is RD. So this is I as in the imaginary number. So these are complex exponential. And this is just the inner product between x and m vector w1 wm. And again, this vector, you can think of them as chosen uniformly at random according to some distribution. OK? Does it make sense? So these are complex numbers, and then you just have to multiply them, and you get the real number anyway. OK? So it's a kernel. It's very simple. A what? The data? It's not there. So the question is, where? Am I using the data to define this? And the answer is no. One difference between this method and this method is that phi tilde here is a random variable that depends on the data. Phi tilde here might also be a random variable, but with respect to some stochastic sources of vectors w1, wm that you choose. Okay? Is it clear? This stuff like this is usually referred to as Nystrom method and friends, and stuff like this is usually called randomized or random features. So let's try to give an intuition that we didn't leave last time of what's going on here, okay? If you solve this method here, what you have is that you're looking at this big kernel matrix, k hat. What are you doing when you're doing this? How much of the kernel matrix you're looking at? Well, a simplistic way to reduce the dimensionality of the problem, if you have too many data points, is to just throw away data. Okay? So instead of n points, you want to use m. In this case, which part, and suppose these are the first m for the sake of simplicity. If you were to just throw everything away but the first m, which part of the kernel matrix would you be considering? Lower right, I would say the upper left, but it's the same. I said the first few, right? So you're just taking the first M and throwing everything away, so you're just building this smaller matrix. If you do that, I mean, if M points is enough, good. Otherwise, you're lost, okay, because you're throwing away data. If you're doing this trick here, it's true that you're just using M centers to expand the function, but the training error is still going to be based on all the data. So which part of the data matrix, of the kernel matrix, you're actually considering? No longer this only this small little block, but what? Well, look at here. What is this? This is essentially like considering a whole thin long matrix, which is, by the way, the same as this. So what you're really not considering is this. Okay? So this is a much richer representation, much richer approximation. And for the courage of you that were listening to me blabbering on Monday, you can prove that this, in fact, if you choose m roughly order square root of n, you can show that with high probability is as good as using the whole thing. Okay? In certain assumptions that are the same assumption of which this is a good idea. Whereas if you throw away the data, if you use the small one, there's no hope. Okay? Because you're just throwing away the data. But this I cannot tell you unless you were there on Monday. What about this guy? Where is this coming from? Well, this is coming from just from class 1 or 2. Remember, and while this is a technique that holds for any kernel, the example I'm going to make here holds for the Gaussian kernel. Remember that the Gaussian kernel can be, it's a kernel of two variables, let me just do it like this, but it can be written as a function of one variable, which is the difference of the two, right? Let's just do the one-dimensional case for what matters. Doesn't really matter. And remember that one idea is that when you write this, you can try to use the, let's try to use the Fourier transform, okay? So I tell you where I want to go before I do the calculation. I want to try to write this as the expectation of a product and then replace the true expectation with an empirical expectation. So I want to show that this kernel is an expectation of something. And then to find an approximation, I'm just going to find an empirical average in place. I want to put an empirical average in place of the true expectation. And I'm going to get this guy. Okay, so let's do it. I want to use the anti-transform of this, which means that I have to do d omega. Okay. Q omega hat. Too many hats here. Bar. Bar is the Fourier transform. I don't think I've ever seen this, but because tilde I use here and hat I'm using there, so that's u bar. Okay. And then I have to do the anti-transform, which is just going to be what? E omega with a plus. But then I have to put this one point here. So this is x minus x prime. Okay? Let's massage this a little bit. I just split the exponential. Not a big deal, of course. But if you look at this now, remember, what is q hat omega, q bar omega? If q was the Gaussian kernel, what is this? It's simply Gaussian, right? So it means that up to a renormalization, you can view this as a probability density, right? dp omega, if you want. Correct? This is just dx e to the d omega e to the minus omega squared divided by something. So this is a distribution. But then this is exactly what we wanted, because this is now just an expectation, right? Is the expectation of what? Of the product of these two guys averaged with respect to the true distribution dp omega. Okay? So let me perhaps write it here. What we have is that this is equal to the expectation with respect to p. The notice is not the p of the data. It's nothing to do with the data. It's just something that we chose. In this case, it's the Gaussian of e to the minus e omega x prime times e to the omega x. And notice that the difference of sign here is because these are complex numbers, so you have to take the conjugate of the other. This is just the usual product of two numbers, okay? This is an equality. So the Gaussian kernel, for example, up to constant that I didn't look up, so I don't remember where I have to put them, can be written like this, where here you just put the Gaussian kernel. Omega, say, well, in fact, just in 0. Okay? So up to renormalization, if you take the Gaussian kernel, you just sample W's, and if you have enough, in fact, infinitely many, you have an exact equality. Okay? Does this make sense? I just rewrote the one example we saw in class 1, and instead of an integral, I'm telling you that it's an expectation. And suppose now I ask you, okay, give me a finite dimensional approximation of this expectation, what would you do? Well, you replace the integral with the finite sum, doing what? Well, sampling m, w1, wm. And then you just do this, okay? Because you can replace this quantity with and if you want here, I have this extra normalization, okay? So you could put here 1 over square root of m if you want. So that now everything is fine. Okay? Does it make sense? This is just for the Gaussian kernel, okay? Of course, for any, for many, many, many kernel for which these first few equations hold, you can use this technique to build randomized feature for the kernel, meaning this kind of finite dimensional approximation, okay? And in fact, there are other kernels for which you can do the same. There are kernels that are defined, for example, by an infinite series, where you can just sample at random elements of the series, and many other examples, okay? But this is the main idea. These are really they share the point of view that they want to approximate the kernel with some finite dimensional approximation, but they're built from two completely different perspectives, okay? And yet again, what I was telling you, that one answer that one question we recently got an answer is, how should you choose m in such a, is there an m, or can you choose m in such a way that by using either this or this approximation, you're as good as if you were looking at everything and doing the full computation? And the answer turns out to be yes. Okay. Here there is a lot of literature, okay? And recently there has been a lot of attempt to try to scale up algorithms, a bit for kernels, but a bit for, you know, just generic linear systems. And this idea, using some kind of randomized techniques, seemed to be the way to go to try to break the complexity barrier, which again, oftentimes comes from space constraints, even before it comes from time constraints. Okay? So this is more or less, you know, this is the recap of last time with a bit of an expansion on this last point that I skipped. The original paper, so this idea, I call it Nystrom. It's really not much Nystrom, and this is originally proposed by Small and colleagues. This idea, which is relatively simple because it's really just this couple of lines together with this couple of lines, had been proposed by Ben Recht and Ali Rahimi a few years ago. And then both ideas have been expanded quite a bit in the last few years. Any questions about this stuff? Curiosity or existential doubt? So here I just presented the least square. Well, I just discussed this for the least squares. You can imagine that many of these ideas will actually work out fine for other loss functions, okay? Because after all, I'm just replacing this expression with this expression, okay? So I'm basically going from the nonlinear case back to the linear case through some suitable processing of the data. Now, if there are no questions, let me move on to the stuff we want to discuss today. This is one of my, what we're going to present today is one of my favorite things, because on the one hand, it opens somewhat the perspective of how you can regularize, how you can build regularization techniques, meaning techniques that can find a good trade-off between looking at the data and find something simple, so avoiding overfitting. But on the other hand, it bridges two ideas that, as I remarked several times in our presentations here, are often considered as two concepts in competition one with each other: the statistical accuracy and then numerical accuracy. Okay, having good generalization and having good computations. So to somewhat warm, you know, just start this discussion and presenting the method I want to present. Let me ask start with a couple of questions, okay? In fact, just one. Let's write down these two approaches. This is the one we've been seeing so far. This is what you typically call Tikhonov regularization. And this is the one where you instead minimize the error on the data subject to a constraint. You can view this as the Lagrangian version of or this as the constrained version of that, okay? Doesn't matter, okay? This is sometimes called Ivanov. Some other time is called ERM, standing for empirical risk minimization, okay? Although the terms perhaps there is slightly incorrect because there is a constraint. Fair enough. I'm assuming that this you have seen one way or another. Would you call, for example, this an algorithm or a problem? This question might seem silly, but we all agree that typically when you have a problem, then you have an algorithm to solve a problem. Okay? So there is a distinction between these two ideas. Would you call this an algorithm or would you call it a problem? But we've been calling it a learning algorithm up to now. So why nobody complained? Oh, yeah, always. God gave it to me. So is there somebody who would like to call that an algorithm? And if yes, it would be an algorithm to do what? So I guess all of you said that this is a problem because you have to find a solution to this optimization problem, right? I actually claim that there's actually a good reason to call that an algorithm. In which sense? Is an algorithm to do what? Does it solve some problem? Does it give some solution to some problem?
To select
a
hypothesis.
Say?
To select a hypothesis.
Yeah, but what is the problem we're trying to solve if this is an algorithm?
So we reduce the problem of finding an optimal function to the problem of minimizing some function.
What do you mean the problem by which optimal function? Which is the optimal function we're trying to
solve?
Right, so that's the key, okay? So there are two problems going on here. We're both right, okay? This is definitely a problem. This is an optimization problem. It is also a statistical algorithm or statistical estimator, whatever you want to, or a learning algorithm, which is what? If you define the problem of learning and the problem of finding an approximate minimization of the true risk, okay? Over some space of hypotheses. If this is your problem, where this is the expectation of the loss over all pairs, and you want to solve this given data, sample according to some distribution, okay? Then, in some sense, it's okay to, you know, this is an algorithm in the statistical sense. It provides me an approximate solution to this problem. That's fine, okay? There is not, this is just, you know, to make the nomenclature precise because it's going to be useful in a minute. So there is, here you really see somewhat a duality. On the one hand, you consider this to be an algorithm. On the other hand, this is also a problem, okay? And in fact, oftentimes when you analyze something like this, you can provide two different analyses depending on whether you want to be a statistician or an optimization person. If you're a statistician, you don't care how you minimize this. You just say that you can minimize it. And you say that there is an exact solution to this problem. And then you check how far it is from this. And you can prove theorems about that. Okay? On the other hand, if you're an optimization person, oftentimes you forget why this is interesting. Where is this coming from? You just say, well, this is what somebody told me I have to solve. And then you just tell me how to solve this problem. You find an approximate solution to this. And then you tell me how far it is from this true solution, okay? And oftentimes there is this schizophrenic behavior, okay? Depending on which conference you want to submit or which paper you want to write, you call yourself a statistician or optimization person. But is there a fundamental reason to do this? Wouldn't it be nice if in some sense you could derive statistical computational procedure or computational statistical procedure, meaning doing taking an algorithm that is doing both things. It's an actual algorithm in the sense of computations, but also in the sense of statistical accuracy. So that instead of having to do two separate analyses, you could just do one. Of course, there is reason to do this because it's simple and this is a good way to think about the problem, right? You say, I have a loss, I have a penalty, I write down my problem, I can even derive this from a probabilistic perspective, and then I can separate the problem, you know, I'm going to worry separately about computations. But by doing this, you might risk to lose something. What is that you might risk to lose? So you're separating completely the statistical modeling and the computational analysis. What is that you might lose by doing that? Are you losing anything? That's good enough. It's, you know, it seems like a good idea. Could you lose anything? Well, suppose that this is just, as everybody told me at the beginning, it's just a problem, okay? What is the precision needed to solve this problem? Well, typically, the precision is the one that your machine or you decide, but it's as high as possible. Suppose that you use gradient descent. How many iterations do you have to do? As many as possible, up to convergence, okay? But isn't it funny? Because this is not the real problem. This is just a proxy to this problem. Maybe my data are noisy, and certainly they're sampled. So maybe doing all these extra, maybe I'm just doing extra computation that are well beyond what the data, you know, would be will allow me to tell about this problem. You see what I'm saying? Is there hope to tailor the computational requirement not only to the raw amount of data, but perhaps to some notion of statistical accuracy allowed by the data? And the hope would be, if my data are rich and they are informative of the true distribution, I should do many computations. But if my data are not that accurate, I should do less computations. Okay? Sometimes in my head I call this a computational regularization, because you put the requirement of regularizing, avoid overfitting, together with the idea of making something that is efficient. Okay? This, at least for now, this is just half of the story. Okay? We would have to try to put them together. So this is a long blah blah, but I just wanted to try to do an inception of one idea. And now I'm going to give you an example where these two things come together very nicely. So I'm not asking you if you understood what I said, because it was a bit philosophical, but let's just try to give an example and see afterwards if it makes sense, okay? Let's take the square loss and the linear kernel, just to make our life easy. And everything is going to generalize, okay? Not everything, but a lot. So linear kernel square loss, or rather, and here is the algorithm I'm going to propose. Pick W0 equals 0, just because, and then do the following. WT equal WT minus 1 minus gamma over n, x hat transpose, x hat wt minus 1 minus y hat. Okay? One line. What is it? What is it that I'm doing? What is this term here? You recognize it? The derivative of the loss function. So this is the gradient of 1 over n x hat w t minus 1 y hat square. Where is the penalty? Not there. So this term, we don't find this term, right? Where is the constraint? Not there. How many free parameters you have? Two. The step size and t. Okay? For now, let's just try to fix the step size, and let's just think what happens with t. So let's say that you want to fix the step size. Well, this is an algorithm to minimize what? The squared error alone, with no penalty, no constraint, okay? So if I choose this, if you remember, I told you that if you choose this as some maximum eigenvalue, you're good to go. So you can choose gamma as 1 over sigma, where sigma is either smaller than the biggest eigenvalue of, if you go there and look, if you can just do a simple computation, you see that either you have to look at the smallest eigenvalue of this matrix, or if you know, for example, that the data lie in a ball, that's also good enough, okay, just to get an upper bound. So let's assume that gamma is a constant and it's fixed that way, and we're going to see it another reason why this could be a good idea. So it's gamma is out of the way, so there is only t, okay? So that's the only one parameter you can play with. So the question to you is, remember that our goal is not to minimize the empirical risk, okay? Our goal is this. Can I use this iteration to find a good approximation of the original learning problem? The point here is not linear versus nonlinear models, okay? Imagine that that is a nonlinear model. This is not the point, okay? I'm just, because everything I can just lift up with kernels is just to keep the notation simple. So the question to you is, do you think I can use this to find a good solution to that problem? Clearly, I can use it to find a solution of this, okay? But can I use it to find a solution of that? What do you think? I guess the default is no, okay? You're minimizing the empirical risk. You're not regularizing in any way. It just looks like a bad idea. But if I'm asking, you might argue there is hope. So why do you think that could be a good idea? How do I have to use that iteration to get not a solution to this, by a solution to this? Any guess?
Can avoid overfitting by restricting the number of iterations that you go down.
Right. Why? What's your intuition? So that's one intuition, right? So what he just said is perhaps what you can do is play, well, that's a good guess because first of all, we have no other parameters than the number of iteration. So if there is any hope that we can fix this is by, you know, using the number of iteration as some kind of tuning parameter. So clearly we know that if we do too many, we are just going to fit this. So this is going to be a bad idea. So the question is, if we stop somewhere before, maybe there is hope to do something good. So one intuition could be, for example, well, to some extent I'm stopping. I don't solve this exactly. So maybe I'm implicit in putting some kind of constraints on my solution. So maybe there is what some people call an implicit regularization. The number of iterations is doing something like that. Fair enough. That's a guess. That's also the only hope because there's nothing but the number of iterations. Okay? So let me do a couple of plots that you can literally do by yourself with MATLAB in probably half an hour. Or maybe 5 minutes, depending on. So let's take a one-dimensional problem. Let's assume that these are some point, okay? Just a one-dimensional problem. This is my data. Let's also assume, so that my drawing doesn't look too ridiculous, that here I'm using some kind of nonlinear mapping of my data, okay? So that this is effectively a nonlinear map. I start from zero, okay, or anyway from something simple, and then I start to fit. So at the beginning, I'm going to get something that is going to be raised a bit by the data, okay? Then maybe I get something like this. Then maybe something like this, okay? So this is, say, I don't know, iteration 2. This is iteration 10. These are numbers are completely random, okay? This is maybe 100, okay? Then at some point, you get something like this, okay? And then, unfortunately, you keep on going, okay? And if you keep on going, you do what the algorithm is supposed to do. It fits the data. So if it has enough juice, it starts to follow the data, okay? Okay, fair enough. So this is my drawing, but you can actually do a simulation and just try it yourself, okay? Do a little movie, and you're going to see that at some point, it seems that if you do the iteration, there's something nice going on way before convergence, okay? I think this is intuitive. It might be new, but it should be intuitive. Let's do another drawing. Let's still put here the number of iteration. And let's put here two quantity, the empirical risk and the expected risk of my solution. Okay, this W hat T. Okay. How would these two curves look like? So the empirical risk, as the number of iteration proceed, is going to go down. This is called the gradient descent algorithm for the empirical risk. So it's probably going to descend. Okay? And in fact, eventually it should go to zero. If this intuition is correct, what would be the shape of the expected error? Should have a minimum. It should go down up to a point, and then it should go up. Okay? And this should be the sweet spot. If we are right, it means that the number of iteration is the regularization parameter. It's roughly like 1 over lambda. When lambda is big, I fit well. When lambda is small, I fit well. When lambda is big, I tend to find the simple solution. Here is the other way around. When t is small, I'm ignoring the data. When I do many, many, many iterations, I'm fitting the data. It makes sense? All right, we could stop here, okay? But can we do a little bit of reasoning to try to convince ourselves a bit more that this is indeed something like Tikhonov regularization in some suitable sense, okay? So this class of techniques is roughly goes back to, I think, I was interviewing some Russian people in optimization and inverse problems. And according to them, the idea came about around the middle of the 80s. People like Nemirovsky, I don't remember his name, Bakushinsky and somebody else. Poliak. Pretty important people. Observe this phenomenon, okay? Observe this fact, which notice is really the following idea. In some sense, the fact that I can stop is because I don't have a perfect information about the problem. If the number of points increase, okay, I expect these two curves to look more and more similar, and I expect these points to move in which direction? So I say this is n equal to 100. Suppose that I give you n equal to 1,000,000. How would this picture change? Well, this one will still go down, perhaps faster. How about this? This minimum is going to move that way, and this thing is probably going to start to go down a little bit. And then if I have enough points, probably this goes down, and this point just has to go to infinity. So the number of iteration I do seems to be linked to the number of points I have. And this is, you know, my blabbering about computations and statistics. Here you see it popping out. The idea here is that if we are right, and we can convince ourselves that T is not only controlling the amount of computation, but is also the regularization parameter. Here it basically means that if my data are poor, I should just fit a little bit and then stop, because otherwise I'm just approximating the empirical rather than the true error. But if my data are rich, I should keep on going. Maybe I should still stop, but less and less. And this number here, of course, it depends on how much data I have. But also it depends on how good are the data. If I give you the same amount of data and I give you a horrible data set, this point is probably going to move in which direction? That way, because I don't want to fit them much. But if my data, the same amount, are really good, I want to fit in the same, what does it mean good? That this is a good proxy for that. Then this point is going to move the other direction. Okay? So we expect, exactly as in the case of lambda, that T is going to depend on the number of points and control the accuracy. But the news here is that if the algorithm is not been invented by me one night, then it should do what I promise. So my philosophical blabbering at the beginning, it controls at the same time computation and statistics. Okay? And when you do a cross-validation curve, if you use some proxy of this, basically you stop your computation way before. Think what would you do here. Here you would choose one lambda, And if you use something like gradient descent, you go up to convergence. Okay? Then you choose another lambda, and you go all the way down to convergence. And you do it many times. Here you have no lambdas. You just have t. You just do one iteration, and you stop way before convergence. Okay? So in some sense, this is a simple instantiation of the idea that you can hope to have procedure that are at the same time computational and statistical. Okay? And there is no duality between these two ideas. You kind of try to make them merge. Okay? Okay, is the inception went well? So now what we want to do is to actually do a bit of calculation to convince ourselves that this is actually not too far away from Tikhonov regularization. Okay? So this is unfortunately going to cost a bit of computation, not too bad. Well, let's do one calculation first since I have it here. What is the cost of this? What is the cost of that? What is the cost of one of those iterations? That's an easy one. What is the cost of this? What is the cost of this? This is of size. And this is of size. So this is? And this? So this is how much? Not n squared. Nd, okay? This is just nd. Okay? How many times you have to do this? Let's write it down. So let's compare this. Okay, so this is Tikhonov linear. That iteration is sometimes called Landweber. You can also call it gradient descent with early stopping. And what is the cost? Well, it's nd, say t, or t minus 1. So now compare this to this. Okay? What you see here is that you don't have to multiply by the number of lambdas you try because you have a warm restart. A term that is often used in practice, which I kind of like, is that of regularization path. What is a regularization path? When you have an algorithm like this, when you fix a lambda, that's one possible solution. When you consider a bunch of lambdas, that's a regularization path, okay, from which you typically have to either aggregate or select a solution. Here, the regularization path is for free. Because every step of the algorithm, you get a new solution, which amounts to essentially a new regularization parameter. And you see that you could save. Okay? You could save computation. Memory is the same. So for now, we're not going to play with memory. We're just going to think about computation. Does that make sense? Okay, let's convince ourselves that this is actually not a bad idea. Any questions so far? How many of you have seen this trick before? This is what is called early stopping, and it's one of the main tricks when you train neural networks, large neural networks. That's a question, or have you seen it? Okay, so let's see. So this counting is interesting to me because to some extent this seems, if you're right, this seems to be a pretty nice idea. It's very much used by practitioner, but it's one of those things that seems like a hack and didn't make it to, it seems at least, according to the statistic, which is pretty consistent in my experience, didn't make it to be used all the time. And one reason could be, for example, because it just looked like a hack and it doesn't have any foundation. In fact, one can prove pretty much everything about this. And here I'm just going to give you an argument and I'm not going to push it too much, okay? Try to convince you that this is not a hack. This is actually a very principled way of doing things and one should give it a shot. So what we want to do is write down the solution. So the claim is, I don't want to read this, so I'll just do this. The claim is that the solution at step capital T can be written in closed form in the following sense. Wt, I can write like this. Gamma over n sum t from 0 to t minus 1 identity minus gamma over n x hat transpose x hat t x hat transpose y hat. Okay? It's a claim. I claim that the solution at step t generated by this iteration can be written this way. Okay? So how do you prove it? You prove it just by induction. The base case is really trivial. And so what you should do, let me just give you a hint and not finish so that we can keep on going. And if you don't manage, we can look at it again. So by induction, it means that you assume that you want to use that recursive equation. And we want to assume that this is true for WT minus 1. Okay? So let me just rewrite the order of the equation you see over there, or rather factorize. So I want to write identity minus gamma over n x transpose x hat times what? W t minus 1, okay? Over there. And then I just have one extra term, which is minus gamma n x hat transpose y hat. Correct? You see better than I do. Is that right? No, it's a plus. Okay? So all you need to do now is to take this equation for t minus 2 and plug it in here. Well, let's do it because it's really just one passage. Okay? So identity minus, or let me do it the lazy way. Hop. If I take that expression and I plug it in here, okay, now I have that this guy is exactly the same guy that appears in the sum. When I pull it in the sum, the number of adden becomes the same, remains the same, but I raise the order of this by 1. So this is going to be sum gamma over n, but not from 0 to t minus 2. It's going to be from 1 to t minus 1. And then I claim I'm done. Do you see why? So is this fine? Do you see why? I just pull this inside of this sum. The number of terms in the sum remains the same, but I have to raise the order by 1. So instead of from 0 to t minus 2, this goes from 1 to t minus 1. Okay? What I wanted to prove was this equation with t minus 1. So what I'm missing here is the 0 term. Okay? The 0 term. Is that correct? So I would like to be able to put here a 0. I'm missing one term. Luckily, I have something here. And what is this? Well, this, if you want, is exactly I to the minus gamma n to the 0, which is just the identity. So I could put it here. OK? It makes sense? So you can plug this also inside of the sum. And that basically means that this will become t equals 0. And we're done. OK? That's the usual tedious proof by induction, where you just have to do a couple of calculations. But that's it. So this proves that this expression is true. OK? And I think that expression is actually enough to convince ourselves that this is like Tikhonov. Can I erase this? OK, let's convince ourselves. This is going to be a little interlude, OK? Take the sum between j, or rather t t and infinity of a number aj, a to the j, where a is a positive number smaller than 1. How much is this? Is what? Good enough? Let's call this b. Okay? Then I can write that b minus 1 is equal to all right. Up to now, everybody should be quite happy. Now, the magic is that this equation works if here, instead of a number, I put a nice matrix. For example, a symmetric and positive definite matrix. And let's take, for the sake of simplicity, that the matrix is also invertible, so that I can write their left-hand side. Okay. So suppose that now I have a matrix. Let me call it C. What happens is that I can write C minus 1 as sum okay, provided I need this some constraints that ensure the series to converge. And this is going to be that the norm of this has to be smaller than 1. Okay, so that this converge. This is not a proof. This is not any kind of argument. This is just an analogy and an announcement that something that one would hope to be true is true. If this matrix, under there are several assumptions, but in particular for us, this will be, we're going to use exactly this kind of idea, where this is a matrix which is positive definite and symmetric. Okay? Now, this starts to look familiar. Okay? Clearly, if I put here, instead of t minus 2, infinity, what you can check is that basically what you're doing is that you're just inverting this matrix. Okay, so call this C hat gamma. Okay, call C hat 1 over n x transpose x. The claim here, this is actually not too different from this. Just instead of an infinite sum, we just have a finite sum here. Okay, let's think a second. Forget about that for a second. Let's just think a second here. What happens if I put a finite sum? What if I put a finite sum here? Because that's enough to look with numbers. Well, I'm going to lose the equality. And I'm just going to get some approximation, right? And note that this number is smaller than 1, okay? So I'm going to have smaller and smaller contributions because they raise to higher powers, okay? But I'm going to get a better and better and better and better approximation. So by keeping this, for t small, I'm getting somewhat the most relevant element in this series. But then if I keep on going, I keep on adding smaller terms. Is this clear? Well, here the intuition, and we're going to make it even more precise in a second, is the same. You have a matrix, and in some sense you're doing a series expansion, where instead of looking at the full series, you truncate. Okay? Is the analogy clear? So this is the end of the interlude, okay? What you can take an inverse, you can do a power expansion, and you then truncate the power expansion. This you can do for numbers, but you can do the same thing for matrices. You do a Taylor expansion, this is called the Neumann series, and then you truncate the Taylor expansion, not the Taylor, the power expansion, and what you have is some kind of approximation. It still remains to be seen why the higher terms are less important than the previous term, but we're going to see that in a second. Okay? For now, just enjoy the analogy, okay, with just the real case. Now, this equation can be complicated a little bit. Okay? so that here what I really get is the pseudo inverse of the matrix X. So what I mean is that the following also holds true. The pseudo inverse, well, first of all, okay, let me write this. What I'm writing here is not, doesn't add anything conceptually, but it's just a refinement just to, okay, so a slightly refinement of this is this equation here. So the pseudo inverse of X is equal to the following quantity. Okay? Seems plausible. Now, what this means is that you're literally just finding an approximate solution to this least square problem. The least square problem is solved exactly by X dagger applied to Y hat. And here, the idea is a power expansion, and let's just truncate. Okay? So this is the most complicated part of this class, okay? Let's make a couple of observations. The first one. You see another reason why gamma can be chosen to be a constant. Why is that? Well, I need the norm of this whole number to be smaller than 1. If it is, I can just drop this. But suppose that the biggest eigenvalue of 1 over n x transpose x is some value bigger than 1. Then I'm just going to pick gamma so that I renormalize. Whoops, surprise. It's exactly this, okay? So we knew this from gradient descent. Here you just refine the same story from just the idea that this series should converge. And now that you know that and you fix gamma, you truncate. Okay? So this already goes in the right direction, right? Because what is Tikhonov doing in the end of the day? He's taking an inverse that we don't like because it might not be invertible and replace it with something which is invertible. But it's not quite the stable approximation of the inverse. What does it mean, stable? That the smallest eigenvalues are going to count a little bit less, okay? And here, the claim is that this t is going to do the same thing. For higher t, the smallest eigenvalue are going to matter more. For smaller t, the smaller eigenvalue is going to matter less. Okay? So if you're not dead, I'm going to do this last step too. So far, so good? Okay, so let's just take a step back and see what we've done so far. So we blabbered a little bit about the fact that we want to try to get something was at the physical and computational, and observe that somewhat here we're really just separating the two requirements. And then we pull out of our hats this iteration here, which at first seems weird. Because there is no regularization and no constraint. So this seems to go in the wrong place. And it does. It goes in the wrong place. It minimizes the empirical risk. And then we start to convince ourselves that perhaps if we don't go there, if we stop before, we can get something reasonable. We do some beautiful drawing. Some other beautiful drawing. And we give up and do some more mathematics. Okay? And convince ourselves that A, this iteration can be written in closed form this way. This is where the argument is going to be special for the square loss, okay? And B, we convince ourselves that this expression from a modeling perspective is right, is a way to find an approximate of the pseudo inverse, which is stable, okay? It goes in the reasonable direction. Notice that I could have started here. Instead of pull this out of my hat, I could here and say, look, something else that gives you an approximate inverse. Here it is. Let me convince you that it indeed gives you an approximate inverse. That's fine. That's what's written here. But if you have to compute this, what's the cost of this? Well, it's brutal, because you have to take this matrix times this matrix, and then multiply it to itself, and then to itself, and then to itself. This is going to be as bad as Tikhonov. It's going to be n cube, or d cube, or nd cube, or whatever it is. You definitely don't have this nice complexity as you have here. So this gets you closer to Tikhonov and to approximate inverse, but this is the way to go for computations. And these two things are equivalent. It's not like this is an approximation. These are equal, okay? So that's where we are right now. What we want to do next is take the last step and use spectral theory, which is very fancy. You see that we use it in a relatively simple way, to convince ourselves even more that this is another way to do what Tikhonov regularization does. So it's the same kind of statistical idea, just through a different implementation principle, which is computationally more favorable. So I need the SVD of this matrix. Okay? I need what we want to do next is to consider the SVD of the data and just rewrite these expressions using the SVD. Okay? So I'm going to use that, and then I'm going to use the following fact. Suppose that you have a nice matrix, a matrix which is symmetric and positive definite. Let's call this matrix C hat. What does it mean to take a function of this matrix? We don't know. We don't really know what does it mean to take a function of a matrix. But let's say that we define it to be the if this matrix here has eigenvalues vi, eigenfunction, eigenvector I, and eigenvalues sigma I, the action of this could be written as sigma, the action on this over, I'm going to get there. The action of this matrix over some vector w can be written how? Well, there's going to be some rank. But then if I want to use the eigenvalues and eigenvector, I can write it how? I can try to write the vector w on the basis given by the eigenvector, and then the action of this is just going to become a multiplication, right? So this becomes sigma I w vi vi, correct? And you can write it in vector notation if you want. But this is just what the diagonalization. So up to a rotation, which is this, this just becomes an identity, okay? Identity with eigenvalues on the diagonal. Not the identity, a diagonal matrix with eigenvalue of the diagonal, okay? So when you take a function of that matrix, what you mean is that you actually have a function from R to R, and this operation you're doing on the eigenvalues. So I rewrite what I wrote here. So if you apply this to a vector w, this is a matrix, and its action almost looks like this. The difference is that instead of sigma I, you write g of sigma I. Okay? This is a fact, okay? Spectral theory is basically the branch of linear algebra and functionalize that tells you how to deal with function of, among other things, how to deal with functions of matrices, but it's actually looking at functional over their spectra, okay? Why am I bothering you with this? Because what I want to do is convince you that Tikhonov is just the choice of one function, and Landau or gradient descent is a choice of another function. And these two functions are different, but not that different, okay? And they kind of do the same thing. It makes sense? That's what I want to do next. And we're kind of done, Because basically, what you want to do is exactly write down this function. So C, but it's really that C, actually, OK? It's just I want to take as C not just any matrix, but this matrix. But then what we know is that if this matrix admits this singular value decomposition, this other matrix admits a decomposition where I have to use these eigenvectors. And instead of these values, let's say I have to take the square of those values. And that's it. OK? So, one, when we talk about the function of a symmetric positive definite matrix, what we mean is a real valued function applied to the eigenvalues. In the particular case where the matrix is this, then I can just consider the SVD of this, and that's it. OK? Remind me what's Tikhonov. Tikhonov is just some approximate inverse, OK? Well, help me out, OK? Suppose that I want to apply this idea and write down C hat 1. Let's say it's invertible for a minute. How do I write it? Using this idea. It's just sum J from 1 to, I put it this star because it's some rank of this matrix. And then what I have to put? Well, I have to do, we said that the operation I do here, I should do on the eigenvalue. So it's, as he said, is sigma I square correct? What about Tikhonov? Tikhonov regularization is just an approximate inverse. How do you do the approximate inverse? You take C, and then you add what? You add something on the diagonal, right? What? You do X transpose X plus lambda identity, right? Let's do it. And then you take the inverse, OK? I want to use this stuff again. So I write here W. And this is sum from J to 1 of the star. What do I have to write here? This side. Somebody please me with the answer. By now, you should start to see how the games go, right? You see where you have a C? You put a sigma I square. Here, there is something more. You have to do plus lambda I. But you have to think of just what you have on the diagonal, right? So what is plus lambda I on the diagonal? It's just plus lambda, OK? So you need to do sigma I square plus lambda to the minus 1, correct? OK. I'm going to write down here because otherwise I have to erase everything. So you have to stand up to. What about here? You see? I just rewrote that guy, OK? I just wrote this guy. So let's do the same game. By now, you should really have understood the way this works. So what do I have to write here? So I'm going to write that VI, VI, sum J from 1 to D star. What do I have to write here? Okay. But then you see, did I make some mistake? That sounds very reasonable. I have to write the same function, okay? Okay. I just rewrote things in a different way. I just wrote it on the eigenbasis given by this matrix C hat, which is the second moment matrix of my data. Okay? This actually gives us a lot of juice. First of all, what you see is that by when you're taking this operation, you're really taking the same operation on the eigenvalues. So when the eigenvalues are small, this operation here is really going to kill them. Okay? For small eigenvalues, this contribution is going to become very, very small when t is large. Okay? Or in other words, the truncation here, in this case, the truncation is going to affect much, much more small eigenvalues than big eigenvalues. Does that make sense? So in some sense there, we were discussing the fact that we had this idea that by taking higher, making more precision, this is obvious with number. With matrix, it's a little bit less clear. But now that you are here, these are back to numbers, OK? Eigenvalues are small numbers, and the truncation affect them a lot. Small eigenvalues, bigger eigenvalues are less affected, OK? And then you really see that these two things are just very similar. Okay, they both, the effect of this t and this lambda is both to depress the contribution due to small eigenvalues. Okay? Yes?
The mass means like I minus gamma c, right? Or is c has a 1 by n x transpose x? Why do you have 1?
Because I made a mistake. You want this? Yeah, just because I'm playing around there. So by definition, I plugged in the n is inside the CC transpose, the C hat. Thanks. So at this point, again, this is not a proof, OK? That this is a good statistical algorithm, but the evidence that is really the same thing as Tikhonov through the stopping start to mount. Okay. At the beginning, we just have a vague intuition with some drawings. Then we give this, it starts to look like an approximate inverse. And here we really see that we are just dealing with numbers and just way to write sigma squared to the minus 1 approximate ways. Now, if you have a bit more of a signal processing background, you should feel like those functions are doing something that you've seen in signal processing before. What kind of functions? What kind of filter is this? A filter in signal processing is something that let pass some frequencies and not some others. Okay? So keep the question there for a second and think a second about it. Here we're going to learn a couple of nice things. Make a plot, okay, where what you do is that you take these kind of coefficients and a function, you write it on the eigenbasis, okay? So suppose that you have a W star. I give you a W star, and you write it on the eigenbasis. But the eigenbasis now are ordered. The eigenvector corresponding to big eigenvalues, I'm going to write first, those that correspond to small eigenvalues, OK? The eigenvalues are positive, and you can always order them in a non-increasing fashion. So I can do this. And the idea here is now that essentially what we're doing is that by choosing these functions, we are choosing what you might call what in signal processing. By signal processing, you would call that low-pass filtering, OK? That's also PCA. But that's really what you call low-pass filtering. What's a low-pass filter? Well, on some notion of frequencies, which here is what? You view these eigenvectors something like a Fourier basis. And this sigma as providing an analogous of high frequency and small frequencies. It's just an analogy, okay? But it stands. And then at this point, what you have is that high frequencies are actually depressed because you get something that looks like, okay? Both of those two equations, the one, the sigma plus lambda to the minus 1, which is kind of a, what I think is called the Wiener filter, and the other one, which is a truncated power expansion, they both give you things that look like this. So they're very similar philosophically, okay? And again, this is the last evidence that these two things are really doing the same thing, just choosing two different shapes. And that's why we want to start from here, okay? Because if you start from here, they really don't look similar at all, okay? And that's where you really see the difference, because the difference in the computations. If you start from this or from this expansion, they're almost the same thing, okay? I wouldn't have time, you know, the surprise while we had a debate at the beginning looking at this and say, would this work? Of course it works. This is just another low-pass filter, okay? And it just happens that the filtering cut region is governed in one case by lambda and the other case by the number of powers I'm going to take in my sum. Okay? So far so good? So this is the end of the surprise. Yes.
So if you start with a small fraction,
that's exactly what I'm saying. So in some sense, what you want is that the frequency should be the unstable ones. And here is exactly that, because you take 1 over small. Okay? So in some sense, you reweight everything to big and small eigenvalues. Let me add one comment before everything starts to pack, because I already have 1 minute. So this is the meat of what I wanted to say. Three things. One, the comment that came out when I asked what is this and somebody said PCA is actually extremely relevant. Because what this, think a second about it, what this also says is that this algorithm works if the PCA are a good basis. Because these eigenvectors are nothing but the principal component of this matrix, or the principal components of the data. So this says that all these methods bet on the idea that small principal components should not matter much, okay? First comment. Second comment. You can prove by induction very easily, like we did last time, that you can write the nonlinear version of a version that just depends on a vector of coefficients called C, which is n coefficients. So we haven't had time to do that. Last, you can replace the square loss by any other loss, which is convex, by putting here the subgradient, or if it is differentiable, gradient. This argument, the spectral argument, won't work anymore, and what we need in our justification, okay? But it can be proved. I want to address these two comments because this is the last lecture where we look at these kind of techniques for a while. So from next week, we're going to look at sparse techniques that somewhat change the picture a little bit. We're going to go back to this when we go beyond supervised learning and look at stuff like multitask, multi-output learning. Okay? So if you have any questions, otherwise you're good to go.